in this chapter, we shall show you a few examples set by Muhammad in the hope that they will make you understand better the Muhammadan Muslims and their perverted world view. Muhammad decided to raid a big caravan destined for Mecca that was coming from Damascus. The Quraysh, pestered by continuous attacks at their caravans, decided to confront Muhammad's marauding gang who had come for the kill. In this battle that took place in Badr and marks the beginning of Muhammad's rise to power, the Meccans lost 70 men and about the same number of them was taken as hostage. Showing how Muhammad dealt with the injured and the captives in this war and in others set the tone for the subsequent Muhammadan Muslim savagery that has lasted unto this day. Among the people who were slain was Abu Hakam, called Abu Jahl, a derogatory term used by Muhammad and his followers. Abu Hakam was severely wounded but still alive when Abdullah, the servant of Muhammad, ran up, put his foot on Abu Hakam's neck, got hold of his beard and started insulting the fatally wounded man whom his own people had named the father of wisdom. Abdullah cut off Abu Hakam's head and carried it to his master. "The head of the enemy of Allah," exclaimed Muhammad joyously. "Allah, there is none other God but He." "Ye, there is no other," responded Abdullah, as he cast the severed head at the Prophet's feet. "It is more acceptable to me," cried Muhammad, hardly able to contain his joy, "than the choicest camel in all of Arabia." It is only by knowing these stories about Muhammad that we can comprehend the fascinations that the terrorists have for cutting the heads of their victims and why, when a Muhammadan Muslim mob commits murder, they invoke the name of their God and cry out, "Allahu Akbar," meaning Allah is great. You, our listeners, must always remember that it is because of the example set by Muhammad himself. According to some historians, Muhammad is said to have given orders for Abu Hakam's body to be mutilated and disfigured. Waqidi, page 85. Another man who fell in Badr and whose body was mutilated was Umayyah bin Khalaf. The reference to his mutilation can be found in Sahih al-Bukhari 5.193, narrated by Abdullah. "I saw these people killed on the day of Badr battle and thrown in the well, except Umayyah or Ubay, whose body parts were mutilated, but he was not thrown in the well." These were men with whom Muhammad had personal enmity. According to one hadith, Muhammad had vowed to kill Umayyah a long time before the Battle of Badr. Bukhari 4.826. After 3 days, the bodies of the slain were dragged and dumped in a well. Muhammad stood by the well and looked on triumphantly as the bodies were brought up and cast in. Unable to contain his joy, Muhammad started calling them by name and bragged to the corpses about his victory. The following story can cast more light on the revengeful and implacable character of Muhammad. Among the captives was Abu al-Bukhtari. He had shown kindness to Muhammad in a time that the Quraysh had boycotted him and his family, and they were living in a state of self-imposed house arrest. Muhammad, mindful of this favor, proclaimed that he should not be harmed. However, Abu al-Bukhtari had a companion whom Muhammad did not want to let go. He pleaded for his friend's life, but Muhammad would not budge. So he exclaimed, "The women of Mecca shall never say that I abandoned my comrade through love of life. Do thy work upon us both." Thus Muhammad, feeling released from all moral obligations, killed both of them. Here we see Muhammad not only murdering his prisoners of war, but he also kills someone to whom he owed a favor because he could not let go of the pleasure of taking revenge upon his enemy. In order to understand the kind of mesmerizing and demonic sway that Muhammad had over his followers, it is noteworthy to mention a couple of episodes in relation to the Battle of Badr. One is the zealotry of the two boys who murdered Abu Hakam. These two young men were from Medina. They had never seen Abu Hakam before. All they knew is that Muhammad hated him, and hence they had to hate him also. When they found Abu Hakam at Badr, both of them attacked him and pierced his body with their swords. Bukhari 4.369. Muhammadans recount these stories gloatingly. Each follower of Muhammad attempts to beat others in blind obedience to him. None of them ever try to find out the guilt or innocence of their intended victim. The fact that he disliked Islam and that Muhammad hated him was enough proof for his culpability, and those young men vied with each other to kill him. Muhammadans for 1400 years relish listening to the details of this gruesome murder and release a sigh of relief. The same mentality permeates the followers of Muhammad even today. And if, for example, Salman Rushdie, who in the eyes of the Muhammadans is the equivalent of Abu Jahl, is murdered, a great number of them will celebrate and jubilate in the streets all over the world. Another story about how Muhammad had brainwashed his followers is that of Abu Hudayfa, whose father's corpse, along with other victims of Badr, was dragged and tossed into the pit. Waqidi 106, Hisham 230, Tabari 294. Abu Hudayfa was overtaken by emotions watching his own father's dead body being thus unceremoniously dumped into a hole in the ground, piled with other corpses. Upon noticing his distress, Muhammad turned to him and inquired, "Perhaps you are distressed for your father's fate." "Not so, O Prophet of Allah. I do not doubt the justice of my father's fate, but I knew well his wise and generous heart, and I had trusted that the Lord would lead him to the faith. But now that I see him slain and my hope destroyed, it is for that I grieve." We shall never know what moved Abu Hudayfa to tears, whether he really grieved the death of his father out of filial love and humanity, or was he distressed for him dying in disbelief. In reality, this conjecture is not important. What is important is the obscene degree of zealotry and sycophancy of the companions of Muhammad. They prided themselves and tried to outperform each other in demonstrating bravado, being heartless, ruthless, and brainless. Today's Muhammadans also pride themselves for having exactly the same qualities of zealotry and mindless devotion as did their ancestors. They congratulate the families of the terrorists killed in action. The mothers of suicide bombers rejoice when the news of their decimated children reaches them. Showing emotions of grief is considered lack of faith. Another one of the hapless captives was Nadir ibn Harith, a poet who was more popular than Muhammad when he was preaching in Mecca. Muhammad was envious of him as his stories about the kings of Persia gathered more crowd, a sin that cost him his life. Waqidi, page 101, Hisham, page 251, Tabari, page 297. The prisoners were brought up before Muhammad. As he scrutinized each, his eye fell fiercely on Nadir, the son of Harith. "There was death in that glance," whispered Nadir, trembling, to a bystander. "Not so," replied the other. "It is but thine own imagination." The unfortunate prisoner thought otherwise and besought Musab to intercede for him. Musab reminded him that he had denied the faith and persecuted the believers. "Ah," said Nadir, "had the Quraysh made thee a prisoner, they would never have put thee to death." "Even if it were so," Musab scornfully replied, "I am not as thou art. Islam hath rent all bonds asunder." Miqdad, the captor, seeing that the captive, and with him the chance of a rich ransom, was about to slip from his hands, cried out, "The prisoner is mine." At this moment, the command to strike off his head was interposed by Muhammad, who had been watching all that passed. "And, O Lord," he added, "do thou of thy bounty grant into Miqdad a better prey than this." Nadir was forthwith beheaded by Ali. To justify that murder, Muhammad made his Allah reveal the following verse, Al-Anfal 8.7. "Ye wished that the one unarmed should be yours, but Allah willed to justify the truth according to His words and to cut off the roots of the unbelievers." The hadiths are full of more such depravities, inhumanity and bestialities that we see almost every day in the news media from all over the world, conducted by the modern followers of Muhammad in the name of Allah and Islam.